Folks in Lakeway watch this. You guys know if you've been here for a while, I kind of like to move. So they see me going out of the picture and into the picture. So if you're praying for something, pray for the sound. The sound over there at Lakeway is not doing right. So we're still trying to figure that out. And Lord, you're in charge of technology. So we'd appreciate your intervening for us. Let's open with a prayer. Dear Father, thank you so much for technology. Thank you for the ability to be here and be there. Father, the most important thing is you, your lordship over our lives, our relationship with you. Sure, one of the reasons we come is to be with friends. But the main reason we come, Father, is to be with you, to learn more about you, not just to fill our heads with knowledge, but to fill our hearts with love for you. Father, as we always do, we ask that you be the speaker tonight, that the words are individual to each person here in some small way, something that we have read or discussed or said might bring us closer to you. We pray, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. This last weekend, my wife and I went to one of our favorite places on the planet, and that's the Oregon coast. We went to a place called Cannon Beach, and that's just a glorious place. But something interesting happened in the trip. So before we got on the plane, I went to the little kiosk, and I got a book to read, and I got a package of cookies to eat while I was on the plane, and I got in and sat down. Pat was one seat over. We had a middle seat between us, and I put the cookies on the seat in between us, and I was reading my book, and actually there was a guy right on the other side, so it was me and then an empty seat and then a guy, and then Pat was over here by the window, and so there was a guy that sat across the empty seat from me, and I was really engrossed in my reading, and then I noticed this guy was opening the package of cookies. And nice guy, didn't want to say anything, and he ate a cookie, and so I thought, well, my cookies, I'm going to eat a cookie. So I grabbed a cookie and ate the cookie, and a little while later he grabbed another cookie, and okay, I'm grabbing a cookie and eating a cookie, you know, and so we're going on along, and we finished that whole package of cookies until the last one, and the guy broke the last cookie in half, and ate half of it, left the other half for me, I guess. And I'm trying to be a Christian, right? Share with your brothers. But I was pretty perturbed, and we got off the plane, and I was going to tell Pat something about it, but she took off to go do something. So I sat in one of the seats, and I opened up my briefcase to do my CBS study, and there was my package of cookies. Sometimes we judge a little too quickly. Sometimes we judge without complete information of what's going on. It's what's going on here in part. People are having a hard time judging who Jesus is. So Mark presents Jesus as Lord. He tells us unequivocally, Jesus is Lord. As we always do, we'll ask first what, and then so what, and then now what. In our first part, we'll ask what. And the answer is Jesus is Lord, as shown by four different controversies. Then when we ask so what, we'll show that Jesus is Lord through three judgments about Jesus. And then finally, in the Now What, we'll talk about how we can show Jesus as Lord three different ways. We've all experienced our study, and it goes so fast, as we've remarked through Mark, that Mark presents things so quickly. But in actuality, Jesus, in our lesson tonight, completes his first year of ministry. So in Jesus' life, we've been through his infancy, we've been through his baptism, we've been through John the Baptist proclaiming, "Behold the Lamb." We're in the spring of 29 AD. We've seen Jesus has done his temptations, gone through the temptations in the desert, and come out and perform his first miracle at the wedding in Cana. Very likely he's cleansed the temple. He's had his meeting with Nicodemus at night. He's healed a Roman official's son. He's cast out demons. We've seen in our lessons that he has healed Peter's mother-in-law. And probably he's had that first miraculous catch. He's healed a leper. He's healed the paralytic. He's driven out evil. And once again, Jesus went out of Capernaum beside the Sea of Galilee, and a large crowd came to him. And as he's walking along, he sees Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. This is Levi in one of the toll booths on Mopac. I mean, it is that busy, and he's there, and he can drive by on Mopac. He's collecting a toll, and he's getting rich doing that, because he's charging a lot more than the Roman tax, and he's keeping it himself. And controversy number one is the question: why does Jesus associate with sinners like Levi and with sinners like the other people? Because while Jesus told Levi to follow him, Levi left everything, says Luke, and got up and followed him. And that evening, Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, and there were tax collectors and sinners eating with him. There were many people who followed him at this point. The word here for sinners and other people is amharetz, two words. It means the common people. It means the regular people. It means, as Cher said, gypsies, tramps, and thieves. It means everybody, the regular people, the people that go to NASCAR races, the people that go to Aggie football games. These are normal, regular people. They're not T-cells. They're regular folks. Dinner at Levi's house. Maybe it's a retirement party. Maybe this IRS agent is giving a party for all of his friends, saying, "I'm going to take off and go follow this guy Jesus." And he throws a party, and the food and the drink is flowing. Well, he's an IRS agent, so it's probably cheap beer and stale pretzels. But there was a lot of cheap beer and stale pretzels. And people are saying, "Why are you retired? You're a young man. You're rich. You can make a whole lot of money." And Levi says something like, "I'm glad you asked. I want you to meet my friend Jesus. He's worth leaving everything and following him." Jesus heard the question, and he gives the answer. "I have come to call the righteous," not to call the righteous, but the sinners. "I have come to call not those who think they're self-righteous. I've come not to call those who think they're spiritually healthy, but I've come to call those who are poor in spirit. I've come to call those who know that they've made mistakes in their life and they want to follow somebody who can show them the right way." Jesus usually goes where he's welcomed. Jesus always goes where he's needed. He calls himself like a physician. He's a physician that goes to heal the sick. He goes to the sick and doesn't always wait for them to come to him. He comes to those in need of healing. He makes a perfect diagnosis. He provides a complete cure. And he pays the bill for those who are healed. Why does it seem in our lessons that Jesus seems to first call fishermen and common folk and tax collectors? Why not the powerful? Why didn't he go to the religious elite, the great rabbis who clearly could have spread his message? I'm not sure, but maybe since he's first identified as divine, behold the Lamb of God, this is my son with whom I am well pleased. Since he's first identified as someone that's righteous, as someone that's holy, maybe he wants first to go to those who question, am I good enough? Is this holy rabbi interested in me? Does he know the things I've done? Is this just another famous teacher, televangelist? Is Jesus an unapproachable God like the myths of Greece and Rome? Or is he for people like me? And when Jesus hears us ask that question, he says, I have come for those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, who realize they are poor in spirit, and who would welcome me. I think the Pharisees see people like Levi as an opportunity for contamination. Jesus sees them. He sees us as an opportunity for conversion. The second controversy is, why don't Jesus and his disciples fast like the religious people do? John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. How is it that John's disciples and the Pharisees are fasting, but yours are not? Jesus, what's going on here? Last week we had a question about authority. This week the question is about lordship. The first question in our lesson tonight is about the company Jesus keeps. The second question is, why is he having so much fun with them? Jesus says, I bring gladness, not sadness. Joy is the picture of the kingdom of God. Happiness should identify the people who follow me. The kingdom of God is not a solemn procession. It is not a funeral procession at all. It is a wedding party. It's not an old funeral. It's a new relationship. What happens to someone that follows me is it's a new life. I created them a new life, and it doesn't fit in with the old life. It's a fresh relationship. It requires fresh expressions. You can't mix the old with the new, says Jesus. You can't mix law and grace. Can't mix religion with relationship. You can't mix old traditions with new life. It reminds me of Tevye. Remember Tevye, the tanner and fiddler on the roof? And his daughter comes to him and says, I'm going to get married. And he says, oh, good, let me meet this young rabbi. She says, no, Daddy. No, Daddy, he's a Gentile. And he says, no. Tradition. Tradition is what's important. And he hung on to tradition so long that he lost his daughter. Tradition was more important than a relationship with someone he loved. And Jesus says, relationship is more important than performance. I come to give you new life and a new relationship. In the first century, fasting was associated with mourning. They put on a dour face, a gloomy countenance, a look of piety. Look how pious I am. But Jesus says, the kingdom of God is not a funeral wake, it's a wedding cake. The kingdom of God is not a funeral procession, it's a wedding party. I am not a reformer of the old, but a transformer to the new way. But there's a third controversy. Why does Jesus break the law by working on the Sabbath? We saw that he was accused of working on the Sabbath by picking grains of wheat, which was perfectly legal. The Pharisees had added so much to God's good law. We read about traveling a specific amount. In fact, the Pharisees would tie a rope to their front door and measure it out 1,999 steps, and that's as far as they could go. The Pharisees said, you can spit on a rock. That's okay, but you can't spit on dirt because that makes mud, which can be turned into mortar, which is work. They burdened the people. Jesus says human needs trump tradition and man's real life is more important than ritual. I wrote the book, guys. I wrote down the law. I am the one that can interpret it. For the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. And there's a fourth controversy. Why does Jesus break the law by healing on the Sabbath? We read the episode with the man with a shriveled right hand. Jesus says, stand up, stretch out your hand. He doesn't put a salve on it. He doesn't even say, be healed. He does no work. And the man is healed out of trusting in God and following Jesus' word. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. I am Lord over all of the law, says Jesus. And so we ask, so what? My wife pointed me to a book called None Like Him by Jean Wilkin. She tells a story in there of a teacher in an elementary school that is teaching her kids about the days of the week. And she said, I want you to write down, today is Monday, tomorrow is Tuesday, yesterday was Sunday. And the kids write that down. And the next day they come to class and she says, I want you to write down, today is Tuesday, tomorrow is Wednesday, yesterday was Monday. The kids say, are you kidding me? Wait a minute, that's different from what you taught me before. Jen Wilkins says, the problem is not with the message, but with the limited ability of the hearer to understand it. The phrase in chapter 3, verse 5, where it says, the Pharisees had stubborn hearts, does not mean they had cold hearts. It means they hardened their own hearts. They became calloused to the truth so that they were not able to understand it. Some of the Pharisees were so concerned with being holy, like God says in Leviticus, that they approached sin from a preventive side, adding rules and rules and rules to make sure we can stay holy. But Jesus approaches sin from a redemptive side, to restore the sinner to a relationship with his Father. The Pharisees looked down at sinners. Jesus looked for sinners. The Pharisees said, only the worthy are admitted. Jesus said, all are welcome. The Pharisees said, we must have conformation to the law. Jesus said, what you need is transformation by grace. And at that point in working on this talk, I said, does that describe me? Which one describes me? Am I so concerned with conformation to the law, with acting holy, with looking down on others that aren't as holy as me, that I forget that that was not Jesus? That the Pharisees are like in the Olympics when they're doing ice skating. And you know, the first part is where the ice skaters do the figure eight. I mean, perfectly. You know, they don't go out of the line, and they do it just perfectly. And there's no music, and there's no joy, and there's no thrill. And Jesus is like the solo routine to dance at the end of that performance. He's out on the ice skating to Tchaikovsky. The Pharisees are like a pianist playing the scales over and over and over, and Jesus is like Mozart's concerto. That's the difference. So we pay attention. We pay attention to the message and try to understand it. Jesus may be different from everything you've ever been taught about him, but I assure you that he is definitely more than you can imagine. So what? The lesson of Levi is that Jesus is for everyone. No one is irredeemable. Even you. Even me. I mean, come on, who's lower than an IRS agent? I know all of you thought lawyers, but that's not right. Jesus says every sin you ever committed was still future at the time of the cross. To even harbor the thought that there is a sin that you've committed that Jesus cannot pay for is to deny the sufficiency of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. His sacrifice on the cross was sufficient to pay for every sin committed by every person. Craig Gross has a ministry called Triple X Church, and he goes to pornography conventions, and he sets up a booth, and he puts a sign out front of it: Jesus loves porn stars. And he hands out Bibles, and he talks to people that want to know, well, Jesus, is Jesus for me too? You read this week about the death of Hugh Hefner. Craig Gross visited the mansion one time by the invitation of an undercover guy that worked there. He went into Hefner's bedroom, and on the bookshelf was A Purpose-Driven Life. Who knows? But Jesus is for Hugh Hefner. Jesus is for everyone. The second lesson is the fact of feasting. Life is for joy. It's not for gloom and solemn obedience. It's for joy. Jesus said, I came to bring you life and life abundant. Boy, find John 10:10 and underscore it. Jesus said, I came to let you have fun and doesn't matter if I die or if I live. To live is Christ, to die is gain. It's all good. Third lesson, so what, is a high point of healing. Don't you love Romans chapter 8? I quote it so often in here, you're tired of it, but I went back and saw Romans 8:31, four little words. God is for us. The creator of the universe, the holy God, the righteous God is for you. God is about relationship, not rules. He's about partnering with you, not your performance. Can we welcome the Levites in our life? I challenge you to put a CBS brochure on top of your garbage can and say, come to CBS with me. I challenge you to say grace in the middle of the meal rather than the beginning. Have some fun with it. I challenge us all to see Sabbath as a gift from God. Walking Cannon Beach, there's this giant monolith. They call it the Haystack Rock. You look at it, and you look at the beach, and you look at the waves, and you look at the birds, and you say, oh, my goodness, what a glorious picture God has painted, and it's all for me. He says, enjoy life. So now what? Here's the now what. Less dogma, more dog. Less dogma, more dog. Have you ever seen a dog with his head outside the car window going at 40 miles an hour? That's a Christian. That's what we all look like. Boy, we're walking Cannon Beach and people bring their dogs and they let them off the leash and these dogs just scream around the beach having fun, jumping up on people. I want you to do that. Run around, jump. Greet people, sniff. Okay, don't sniff people. But have the joy of life like a dog on a beach. Secondly, less killjoy, more joy. Theologian Lily Tomlin said, the trouble with the rat race is even if you win, you're still a rat. Why do we try so hard to win the rat race? I played golf for the first time in a year the other day. Came up to a hole and there's water on the left and sand on the right. The guy playing with me said, Win, don't hit it to the right. I said, that's exactly where I'm going to hit it because you put that in my mind. When I coached Little League Baseball, I never said don't walk the guy. I never said don't strike out. I said get a hit. Throw strikes. Pharisees see spirituality is avoiding doing wrong things. A follower of Jesus is primarily concerned with doing the right things. If my focus is doing the right thing at the right time, I'm not going to do any wrong things. More joy. And third, be less critical and more relational. This at lunch the other day, a guy sat down and he knew that I was somehow associated with Canicut, the Christian sports camp, and he said, you know what, I was there one time, I was one of the students at Canicut, and I was the goalie on the soccer field, and I know I'm at a Christian camp and all that, and the shot came in, the guy kicked the goal right past me, and I went, uttered a cuss word, and everybody looked at it with big eyes, and looked behind him with big eyes, because there was Joe White right behind the goal. Joe White's the founder of Canicut, and he turned around and said, ooh, sorry, Joe. Joe said, let's take a walk. And they took a walk together at 6 a.m. every day that week. Because Joe was about relations. Jesus is for everyone. Jesus is for joy. God is for us. Let Jesus be Lord of your life. Let's pray. Holy Father God, Thank you for showing us the difference between the Pharisees and Jesus. Let this lesson, Father, fill our hearts with joy that Jesus came for us. Help us draw nearer to him, Father. Help us become more like him. Help us to love him more. We pray, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.